We commonly speak about time as something that moves, flows, or advances. We say that time flies, and we talk about a race against time. Now, for much of the history of science, that intuitive picture of time as something that flows has been reflected in the way in which we do physics. Physicists have written down laws of nature in the form of time evolution equations, which take a state at a given time and tell us how to evolve it forwards in time to arrive at states for later times. These laws invite us to think of the universe as something like a computer, which takes in an initial state and evolves it forwards in time to produce the rest of history. But there's an alternative way to think about the universe. Rather than starting at one end of time and evolving towards the other end, the laws of nature could apply all at once to the whole of history in an atemporal manner. To visualize this, think about the rules of a game of Sudoku. The rules of Sudoku don't tell you to start at the left and move towards the right. Rather, they apply all at once to the whole grid, simply judging a total solution as valid or invalid. And in principle, the laws of nature could work in a similar way, constraining all of space-time at once and choosing a whole solution in one go, rather than generating the course of history moment by moment, as in the evolution picture. Now, if this is correct, it would significantly change the way we think about time and our place in it. Rather than imagining ourselves as moving along with time, we should imagine ourselves as being embedded in it at a particular spot. We are causally related to our past and future selves, but we're not literally moving from the past to the future. Time isn't a journey, rather it's something like a perspective. I have one particular spatiotemporal perspective, my past selves have a different spatiotemporal perspective, and my future selves have yet a different spatiotemporal perspective. From this point of view, the future is already out there, and it's just as real and concrete as the past. Now, why should we take this all-at-once picture seriously? Well, one major reason is because of the phenomenon of non-locality that we see in quantum mechanics. To see how this works, imagine that I prepare a pair of particles and send one particle to my friend Alice in London and the other particle to my friend Bob in Sydney. Alice and Bob now each choose a measurement and perform that measurement on their particles. They may well find that the results are correlated, that is, the result of Bob's measurement is not independent of the choice of measurement that Alice performs in London. Now, there's nothing particularly unusual about seeing correlations at a distance like this. The physicist John Bell pointed out that we can achieve a similar effect if, instead of preparing a pair of particles, I simply take a pair of socks out of my drawer and send one sock to Alice in London and the other one to Bob in Sydney. If Alice and Bob now inspect the color of the socks they have received, they will probably find that the colors of the socks are correlated. That is, the color of Alice's sock will usually match the color of Bob's sock, because I do try to store my socks in matching pairs. And this, of course, is all perfectly understandable. The correlations are explained by a common cause in the past, i.e., the fact that the socks came from the same pair. So, John Bell set out to understand whether or not the correlations appearing in quantum mechanics can be understood in this way in terms of a common cause in the past. He proved a mathematical result showing that any correlations which can be explained like that in terms of a common cause in the past must obey a certain inequality. And the punchline is that the correlations appearing in quantum mechanics violate that inequality, meaning that they are too strong to be explained in terms of a common cause in the past. It appears that the result of Bob's measurement must depend directly on what Alice chooses to measure, as if Bob's particle just knows instantaneously what has happened to Alice's particle, no matter how far apart they are. This phenomenon is known as spooky action at a distance. Now, spooky action at a distance is weird enough, But things get even worse when we try to combine this with Einstein's theory of special relativity. The problem is that special relativity tells us that facts about simultaneity must be relativized to a reference frame. So, for example, considering those measurements made by Alice and Bob in London and Sydney, you might naturally ask, do those two measurements occur at the same time or not? But what Einstein tells us is that there's just no fact of the matter about that. One observer might judge that the two measurements do occur at the same time, but another observer, moving at a different speed, might judge that Alice's measurement occurs earlier than Bob's measurement, and another observer, moving at yet a different speed, might judge that Bob's measurement occurs earlier than Alice's measurement. And what Einstein tells us is that all three of those observers are equally correct. There's just no universal present moment which can determine what counts as the same time for two distant observers in an observer-independent manner. So what happens if we try to combine special relativity with spooky action at a distance? Well, we seem to have a big problem. In this phenomenon of spooky action at a distance, it appears that the state of Bob's particle must change instantaneously when Alice performs her measurement. But the state of Bob's particle can't change instantaneously unless there is some fact of the matter about what counts as the same time for Alice and Bob. Instantaneously just means happening at the same time, after all. So there appears to be an incompatibility between spooky action at a distance and relativity. Quantum mechanics and Einstein's theory of special relativity appear to contradict each other. Now, it turns out that the two theories do not ever make any observable predictions which are in contradiction. So that means we can't just go out and do some experiments to see which one is right. But nonetheless, there appears to be a deep-seated conceptual tension between the two theories, and that is worrying both for philosophical reasons and for physics reasons. Philosophically, it suggests that there's something very significant about the nature of time that we haven't yet understood properly, and for physicists, it means that there are significant obstacles standing in the way of combining quantum mechanics and relativity into a unified theory of quantum gravity. So, how can we resolve this tension? Well, perhaps the answer is to move away from the time evolution approach and towards the all-at-once picture. Because it turns out that the problem I've just described to you is very closely linked to the time evolution model. To see this, imagine a computer evolving the state of the world forwards in time. Clearly, the state of the whole world at each given time needs to be well-defined in order that we can then use that state to calculate the state at the next time. That means that in this phenomenon of spooky action at a distance, we must be able to identify some well-defined moment at which the state of Bob's particle changes, and that needs to be at the same moment as Alice performs her measurement. So this is the origin of the tension with relativity. Spooky action at a distance, combined with the time evolution picture, forces us to decide what it means for two distant events to happen at the same time. And yet relativity says to us that there can't possibly be a fact about that. So what happens if we move to the all-at-once picture? Well, in that picture, there doesn't have to be a well-defined state of the whole world at every given moment. In this spooky action at a distance, there will be an all-at-once constraint which determines the relationship between Alice and Bob's measurement outcomes, but there's no fact of the matter about when Alice's measurement influences Bob's particle. The particles simply respond directly to each other across both space and time in an atemporal manner. Think again of that game of Sudoku. Clearly, the numbers on the left of the grid are going to be correlated with the numbers on the right of the grid because the rules of Sudoku impose a certain relationship on them. But there's no fact of the matter about when the numbers on the left influence the numbers on the right or vice versa, because the rules impose those constraints in an atemporal manner. So in the all-at-once picture, there's actually no tension between quantum mechanics and Einstein's theory of relativity. Quantum mechanics and relativity are compatible with each other, after all. So, quantum mechanics and relativity together give us very good reasons to think that the time evolution model is wrong. Time doesn't flow, doesn't move, doesn't evolve. From the point of view of physics, the whole of history exists at once, and that is how the laws of nature apply to it. So, quantum mechanics and relativity together have very significant consequences for how we should think about time and our place in it. Physicists and philosophers are still trying to unravel what this means for how we should think about time in a future theory of quantum gravity and in our everyday lives. How should we think about our lives if time isn't going anywhere? There's a lot to be uncovered here, and no doubt future developments in physics will bring new revelations on the nature of time. But in the meanwhile, like Ellis and Bob, each of us experiences the meaning of our own time, inhabiting a specific spatio-temporal perspective on the universe that no one has ever had before and no one will ever have again, but knowing that the rest of time lies out there in the future, just waiting for us. Thank you.